everyone, Arnout, wizbiz.com, and today we're going to talk about Silberlingen, Silberlings, which are the tiny vintage electronic modules that came with the fischertechnik building system, the construction system. They have tiny strips on all the sides so that you can cascade them together, and those little strips of course are for the power supply that comes from the rectifier module. There's also one Silberling that acts as a rectifier, providing 9 volts to the other modules when they're cascaded together. Like so. To the left, the rectifier module takes 9 volts alternating currents, and it clips together with a monoflop in this case. So those nifty vintage electronics modules make it possible to do all kinds of electronics experiments with flip-flops, monoflops, relays and OR gates, and as you can see here, make a card go back and forth with an LDR light gate, or up and down with switches directly connected to a flip-flop driving a relay, switching the polarity on the motor. And wouldn't it be a great idea to build our own Silberling with a microcontroller in it that bridges the gap to these vintage electronics modules? First of all, we have to have the same dimensions as the original thing, and let's be a little bit pretentious by calling it the Magic Zauberling! Fischertechnik, after all, is a German product, and Zaubern means to conjure in German. So, we have our prints, we have our fronts. My good friend Dimitri Modeman made all this to perfection. And as you can see, it closes very nice. The blender designs that I made, they fit really good. I have 2 small slides here at the bottom and 2 small slides at the top as well to facilitate the little power supply strips, like so. Let's see if I can give you an impression of how this looks in a moment. Just fold it inwards and connect these inside to have your power supply looped through all the cascaded modules. And with the front on, it's already gonna look like an original Silberling, isn't it? Well, inside there is not too much room for a microcontroller. For instance, the Uno, Arduino Uno, is way too big, as you can see. Never gonna fit in there. The Mega, forget about the Mega. Well, there is a smaller edition of the Mega, and it's on, yeah, it's already too wide to fit in there. That's a pity. We have the Raspberry Pico. It would fit, but it's quite full, and the same with the Arduino Nano. We could save the USB interface, I guess. And there is a microcontroller that does exactly that and has a very, very small footprint. It's the Arduino Pro Mini 80 Mega 328P, which, as you can see, has the ideal footprint for this. So let's take a closer look. A reset button, a processor, and along the edge the TTL level interface for uploading software to it. Even a few pins in the middle of the board, but the rest neatly arranged along the edges of the boards. It has 20 in-outs. That's great. Mine operates at 16 MHz. There's also a 3.3 volt version on 8 MHz, and probably one on 20 megacycles. Never seen that one before. So after all, a tiny, small, magical board that has a lot of capabilities of building our own magical Silberling. If we combine it with a motor driver, a TB6612 FNG in this case. This is the TTL input and output, more about that in a moment. And we have our Silberling 9 volts inputs and an external power supply. So we can switch between those two, because we have to drive motors. Use voltage regulators. As you can see, the brown line is directly going through the motor inputs. So it's driving the motors directly from the external power supply if needed. So that's about the power supply. We need dip switches to configure which program to execute on the module. This can be connected a little bit more economically than I did at this moment, but we'll get into that later. Furthermore, we need an analog potentiometer that needs one analog input. And let's go to the input side. With three dip switches, optionally pulling up the voltage divider on the input so we can use passive sensors as well. And wouldn't it be nice to keep an eye on those inputs with signaling LEDs? For each input, one LED is going to connect to three more outputs of the microcontroller. And so we're ready to make the connections for servos. There are two pulse width modulation outputs to be used for the servos. Let's connect the TB6612 with two PWM lines as well and four normal output lines. So we're finally ready to connect our motor outputs to the TB6612. There you have it. And as you can see, there is also a LED connected to each motor output, giving a little bit of an indication about rotation direction or output voltage levels. So there you have it. Let's translate this to the real world. By the way, everything is in the notes. You find links and schematics in the comments for this video. This is my little test build-up with the infrared obstacle sensors, with a few motors, with a fischertechnik vintage push button, with my own push button for reset and a potentiometer, two servos, and somewhere between all the wires you see three blue LEDs. Oh, I'm triggering one of the inputs now, and that, well, more or less gave me away, because there is already a sketch being uploaded by me, my first test sketch. And to upload, by the way, you need a USB to TTL interface for this board, because it does not have a USB interface on the board. But don't worry, after all, it is quite easy to program it and get your sketch uploaded from the Arduino development environment. It is running now, it is uploading, as you can see. So that's one thing to keep in mind, that you need a USB to TTL interface to program this Pro Mini board. And here you see my solution at this moment. First thing I tried was a cheap module, a USB to TTL serial interface with an FT232RL chip. Unfortunately, this thing was not recognized by my Apple hardware. On Windows, no problems, by the way. So I bought another one, which is more or less a cable style interface with a CH340 chip, and it has loose ends, loose wires with both 3 and 5 volt power supplies, so you can program both the 8 megahertz and the 16 megahertz Pro Mini. The drawback of this line, however, is that it does not have a DTR line, so your computer cannot initiate the upload, and you need to reset your Pro Mini module manually after your software has been compiled and just before it's going to be uploaded to your module. So that needs a little bit of timing and an external reset button, because once your board is being built in, the reset button on the board will no longer be available. And then I came across a very nice idea of how you could use a Arduino Uno that you might have laying around as the TTL interface. Should you go that way, just refer to the project page for more information of how I did get this to work. So, I'm very curious to see if this test setup works. There is an LDR, we have an infrared obstacle sensor, some motors, some servos. There we have our Pro Mini with our motor driver and LEDs on the inputs. Two voltage regulators, one specific on 6 volts for the servos. A vintage push button, fischertechnik style. And let's see if we can run our servo program. Yeah, it does work. So the pulse width modulation outputs do their thing. And it might be very interesting to see how much current the whole thing is using. Well, with servos in use that might go up to 650 milliamps, which is quite a bit. On the inputs, nothing special, just a normal current, which is about around 66 milliamps. Okay, so the inputs are working. Let's check our motor and servo demo. So let me choose the right sub-program within my sketch for the motors. First one is running. One direction. Very good, very good. And probably it will also go the other way around. Very nice. 230 to 40 milliamps. Nothing to be worried about. Let's take a look at the other motor. And in the meantime, on the outputs, you see, well, you probably can't see the LED, the B-color LEDs reflecting direction and speed of the motor. Well, that's working very nice. In the meantime, I've dip switched to my other demo, the servo demo. And it goes through its demo run, consuming much more milliamps, peaks over 1 amp, so it's good it has its own voltage regulator over here, producing a little bit of heat, so perhaps we have to take a look at that. Let's see, that one over there is the main 5 volt going from 9 to 5 volts, producing around 45 degrees centigrade. Nothing to be worrying about. And, well, this one is getting a little bit hotter. This is the servo power controller, getting around 50 degrees centigrade. Probably need a heat sink for that, to be sure. But praxis, I think, within critical limits. What's this? Seems to be some heat being produced over here in the dip switch resistors. Oh, right. Yeah, my mistake. It seems that I'm using 220 ohms only, where I need 2200 ohms. I most definitely have to correct that. For the rest of it, no problems for now. Have to check those dip switches. Yeah, you see, it's up to 72 now with all dip switches in the on position. So if we just slide them back, it goes without the resistors to 65 idle state current. That's okay. So after correcting that, we're all set for producing a prototype. DIY Silberling called a Zauberling to be used with the fischertechnik Silberlings. I give it a reset and I do a little quick power up test. As you can see, it blinks its LEDs, so everything is okay. By the way, take a look at my next video, because this one is already getting way too long. The next video will cover a first application with this Zauberling. So do check the project page on my website, and I hope to see you with the follow-up. Until then, happy hacking!